In the last video, we introduced the barter economy, then expanded upon the barter economy to show the monetary economy. But in the last video, the monetary economy model that we displayed had no way of showing any potential for savings and investment. But we know in reality, you do have the potential to save money and to invest money. And it didn't include these financial markets and also didn't include the government. So now we're going to expand upon that same monetary economy model from the last video to include the financial markets, to include government, and include the potential for savings and for investment. Now the first thing that we're going to notice is households. Households are considered net savers, which means they typically bring in more than they spend. So what is a household going to do if they earn more money than they spend? Well, they're going to become these net savers and place this money in the bank. Well, what is a bank's job? A bank's job is to make money. How do they make money? Well, they make money off of the interest on loans, on the money that they loan out. Well, they get the money from savers. So net savers, these households place money in the bank. The banks then loan out that money, and they'll loan it out to other households, to businesses, and to governments. But on the aggregate, if you look at all of the households, typically all of the households make more than they spend in a summation, and on the aggregate. That's why they're considered these net savers. Does not mean that every household is a net saver. It just means that whenever you add up all of the earnings from all the households, less all of the expenses from all the households, we see that they actually do save money. So they're going to be net savers. So we see these households take their net savings and they place them in these financial markets. These financial markets then loan out money to these businesses and to the government and also to other households. So businesses, they are considered net borrowers because they tend to spend more than they save. Businesses on the aggregate spend more than they save, so they need to borrow to make up this deficit, which makes them these net borrowers. And they borrow that money from these financial markets. So what do they do with that borrowed money? What do the businesses do with that borrowed money? Well, first and foremost, the businesses with that borrowed money and with the money that they earn from selling products or services, it goes back to the households. They pay it back to the households in terms of wage, rent, interest, and profits. So if you remember back to that basic model, we said that the households bought goods and they paid consumer expenditures to the businesses. And in return, the businesses provide households with the revenue for their resources. So the households provide the resources and they get paid for those resources. So that's why we say that all the money that the businesses make and the bit money that they borrow goes to the households to pay for those resources from the households. And that comes out in terms of wage, rent, interest, and then in profit. And as we said in that last model, that the summation of the wages, rent, interest, and profits is known as the national income. So now if we continue on and begin to, and that pretty much sums up the bottom half of this model. All of this basically talks about the bottom half of the model. The only thing that we don't talk about is the retained earnings. You see, households or businesses, they may flow wage, rent, interest, and profit, and all the money that they make will start flowing to the households, but businesses will actually keep some of the profits themselves, and this is known as retained earnings. So that's the reason for this kind of this backflow, this line right here, is because yes, the majority of the money is going to the households, but some of it will backflow back into the businesses as retained earnings. So now if we move up to the top half of this model, we're going to start looking at the government. The government, they earn their money by collecting both taxes from the businesses and the governments. So the government receives taxes from the households and the businesses, both the households and the businesses. So they receive taxes from those two entities, and then sometimes the businesses and the households may receive some money from the government. This might be subsidies. Subsidies going to the businesses to help them produce more goods. Or it might be a social program money that's going to the households, something like welfare or unemployment. That would be payments coming from the government. But on the aggregate, both the households and the businesses pay more in taxes than what they receive in payments from the government. As a result, we say that these are net taxes. So the government receives taxes from the households and from the businesses, and then whenever the government has a budget deficit, they borrow money. And usually, here, especially here recently, the government has been a net borrower, net government borrowing. So we see that they borrow money in a budget deficit. Whenever they are spending more than they're making in taxes, the government will have to borrow money. And they often do that by borrowing from financial markets or by the sale of treasury bonds. So a lot of times the government will sell treasury bonds to finance their deficits. Also, then coming out the other end, what does the government do with all this money? This government expenditures. They use taxes and borrowed money for these government expenditures. And these government expenditures are often used to buy goods from the businesses. So now we are going to talk a little bit about this of the businesses and what all they buy and what all they use. So we're going to start right here. And the businesses, they'll often buy business investment expenditures, or they'll buy intermediate goods from other businesses. So an intermediate good is a good that is going to be used in production later on. So if we're going to talk about an intermediate good, we might say that a cardboard box might be an intermediate good because it's going to be used for packing and for shipment, and that's going to be used later on in a final good. You see, a final good is a good that's ultimately consumed, ultimately used up. Maybe a better example would be a car. You see, all the parts that go into a car, those are considered intermediate goods because they're used in a later product, are used in the full car. But a full car that's being used by a household and will be ultimately consumed or ultimately used up, that's considered a final good. So what we see is businesses, they'll often have these business investment expenditures. They'll buy these intermediate goods, and that winds up going back and being that money goes to other businesses. So we see that the flow of money would go out of one business and over into potentially another business. We also have these households. The households, they buy goods. So they're using their consumer expenditures, and that's flowing to the businesses to pay for their goods that they're buying. So money for households is made by selling resources. So they make this national income by selling resources, and they use that money to buy goods and services from businesses, and that's called consumer expenditures. So then you have the businesses, and they're buying intermediate goods. That's known as business investment expenditure. And then also the government. The government is buying goods as well. So they're often buying goods from the businesses. So now the businesses, they're providing goods to the government, to households, and to other businesses. And that what all that money that's flowing out of the businesses, out of these consumer or as consumer expenditures, as these government expenditures, the total expenditures is known as the national product. So if you remember back to the last video, we talked about the national product being the sum of all the consumer expenditures. Well, in reality, it's the sum of all of the expenditures, the total expenditures. And now that we have this expanded model, we can actually see that these business investment expenditures, government expenditures, and consumer expenditures all go into this national product. Now, I want to hit on a new term that we might not have seen very much of yet. I'm going to give you the formal definition of it, and that is gross domestic product, or GDP. We're going to be talking about this more in this class, so I really want to take some time and focus on what is gross domestic product. The gross domestic product is the sum of all expenditures of all final goods and services. Notice that we say final goods and services. If you remember from a little bit earlier in this video, final goods and services are those goods that are being used by consumers or the government that are going to be used up. And sometimes they're used by businesses, but for the most part, they're being used by households and governments, and these goods are being completely and totally used up. A car that's being used by a household is considered a final good because that they're going to drive that car until it's no longer viable, until that car is completely used up. But the parts inside of a car are considered intermediate goods because they're going into a final product. And those intermediate goods, the expenditures of the intermediate goods, are not considered in the gross domestic product because they're not a final good or service. So if we wanted to break down another example of another intermediate versus final good, well, we could say that beef that is being consumed in a household is a final good because it's going to be ultimately consumed up by the consumer, by somebody using it. But hay, if you think about hay, what is hay made for? Hay's not made to be just consumed up. It's made to be used in the production of cattle or production of sheep or production of horses. So oftentimes, hay is an intermediate good. Feed is an intermediate good. But the animals that you produce at the end are a final good. Whereas if you look at vegetables that we often eat as humans, maybe it's lettuce, maybe it's sweet corn, maybe it's something of that nature, green beans, those are often considered final goods because those are going to be consumed up. Now the line between intermediate good and final good can often become very gray. There's no black and white, this is a final good, there, this is an intermediate good. It just depends on what that good is being used for. But that definition of knowing what an intermediate good and a final good is very important, especially because when we talk about gross domestic product is the sum of expenditures of all final goods. And the expenditures spent on intermediate goods are not considered in the gross domestic product, or GDP.